Every programmer has ran into at least one sorting algorithm at one point in their career. Today, I'm going to easily explain 10 of the most popular sorting algorithms, as well as the pros and cons of each. Let's go. Bubble sort is one of the most popular sorting algorithms, probably because it's the easiest. Bubble sort has an index that goes through the entire list. If the number it's on is larger than the next item, it switches them and then moves forward. It then repeats this until every single item in the list has properly been solved. And understandably, bubble sort has terrible performance and is only ever used to teach how sorting algorithms work. So algorithms are usually determined by time and space complexity. No Einstein. Not that time and space. Meaning, what's the best and worst case scenario of how fast it can go, as well as the amount of space it consumes. So the worst case for bubble sort is big O of n squared, while the best case is big O of n. Here's what that means in English. N is universally understood as the number of items in the list you want to sort. My Python is showing. In our best case scenario, the array is already sorted, so we need only one loop through them all to determine that. But on the worst case scenario, we would have to exponentially do an operation through this array in order for it to be sorted. Meaning that if there were 5 items needing to be sorted, we would have to do over 25 operations in order for it to be sorted. So do yourself a favor and just skip this one. Selection sort is known as an in-place comparison sorting algorithm, and it's actually fairly easy. This algorithm divides the unsorted array into a sorted sublist, which starts empty and the remaining items to sort, which is all of it for now. The algorithm then goes one by one over the unsorted array, looking for the smallest number. Once the array has been completely looked over this iteration, it then puts the smallest number at the end of this sublist. This happens until all elements are gone and the array is fully sorted. So selection sort has a worst case of big O n squared, as well as a best case scenario of big O n squared. Consistency. Meaning, just like bubble sort, selection sort is not ideal at all. And by the looks of it, arguably worse, right? Well, selection sort always seems to outperform bubble sort in most scenarios, but there's better choices, so let's move forward. So insertion sort is very similar to selection sort. This sorting algorithm does one at a time by constantly comparing. Here's how it works. Insertion sort, like selection sort, creates 2 arrays, one sorted and one unsorted. It goes through each element one by one in the unsorted array. With the element that it's on, it determines where in the sorted list the element belongs to by iterating over each element to see if the number is between them. Now, the worst case scenario is big O n squared, while the best case is big O n. The thing with insertion sort is that it's been implemented in C++ with only 3 lines of code. And what's funny is that this is the sorting algorithm that you use when you're holding up a bunch of cards and you need to sort them. So for very small lists, this might be a great option, but when you're looking big, no. Merge sort is a really popular and a really effective comparison-based sorting algorithm. Merge sort fits in a category you'll see a lot in this video under the divide and conquer algorithms. First, take the unsorted array and divide it into the smallest unit, which is usually just one element. Then you compare each element with the array next to it and sort and merge the list. Continue until you have one array that is completely sorted. Merge sort has a worst case performance of big O n log n. Here's what that means. N, of course, represents the amount of numbers in our list. Log n represents the amount of times n is divided. So if our unsorted array is 16, then log n would be 4. Since we can divide 16 down to 1 in 4 iterations. And best case is omega n log n, meaning it doesn't get faster than this. Essentially, whether your list is a bit sorted already or completely random, merge sort takes about the same amount of time to do its job, making it reliably efficient. But where these divide and conquer algorithms really excel is the ability to do things in parallel. Since things are being split into many, many, many sublists, dividing, sorting, and then merging can exponentially make things faster. It's actually a really awesome algorithm. Quicksort is also one of the most popular algorithms that also uses the divide and conquer sorting strategy. Programming languages like JavaScript, Ruby, and PHP use Quicksort in their standard library features. Is that a flex or? So Quicksort works similar to merge sort, but requires something called a pivot. In the unsorted array, pick a number to be your pivot. This could be the first number, the last number, or the middle number. The number that is chosen as the pivot is then used to compare all values into one of each list. Less than or equal to the pivot, or more than the pivot. A pivot point is then chosen within the newly created list and do another comparison if it's greater or smaller.
Once it does this recursively to all subarrays, it is then considered sorted.
So the worst case is big O n squared, while the best case is big O n log n. But as you can probably guess, getting that pivot is an extremely important factor in the performance of this algorithm. So some do the first, middle, or last element, others just do it randomly, and then others choose the medium of three small samples in order to get a general idea. Otherwise, quicksort is goated. Heap sort is another comparison-based algorithm, also known as selection sort, using the right data structure. So yeah, but first let's talk about the heap data structure in computer science. Heap is a tree-based data structure where all levels are filled except the lowest and is filled from the left to right, often used in priority queues. Max heap is the same concept, but where the highest numbers start at the top and lower numbers are pushed down. And this data structure is used all the time to give fast operations as well as a great priority management. Okay, so here's how heap sort works. Heap sort will take an unsorted array and then start building a max heap in a process called heapify. I know, very creative. This process will constantly validate if the tree is following proper guidelines for how a max heap works. Once the tree is built, the top element switches with the element at the end. The heap is then rebuilt and the numbers switch again. Rinse and repeat until sorted. And this means that the worst and best case scenario is big O n log n. Almost exactly like insertion sort, but doesn't do linear scan of unsorted numbers, instead using the data structure it provides. Whew, okay, that was a lot of explaining. Okay, counting sort is kind of hilarious, so here's how it works. Counting sort consists of three arrays: the unsorted array, the counting array, also known as a collection, and the output array. First, we define the maximum value in the array. This defines the size of the counting array. You iterate over the unsorted array, and for each element, you add to the count in the counting array.
We then calculate the sum of each number to the right sequentially. These numbers represent the amount of numbers before it. Then we go in reverse order in the input array, where we insert in the index that is specified by the value of the number, then subtract by one. Repeat until everything is sorted.
So the worst case scenario is big O n plus k, where k is the range of the smallest number and the largest number. It's a funny one, but sadly only works on integer values. You can't use it to sort colors or names, whatever. Shell sort is an in-place comparison algorithm that is a lot like insertion sort, but on steroids. It works by using intervals. This starts with the length of the array divided by 2. We then compare the first of each array within the given interval. If the first number is larger than the second, it swaps. This array then looks like this. We then divide our interval in half again, with 4 elements per sublist. We iterate over and sort each. When interval hits 1, we use insertion sort in order to sort the whole array. So the best scenario is big O n log n, while the worst case scenario is big O n squared. And the reason why this goes so fast despite using insertion sort is because it creates a partially sorted array before it does that final sort. TimSort was made in 2002 and is still being used to this day in Python. Well, except for 3.11 plus. TimSort separates an array into small subarrays called runs. These runs are then sorted using insertion sort. Once all the runs have been sorted, it then starts to use merge sort on the two smallest arrays. After those have been sorted, it takes the next run and sorts it into the merged array. Rinse and repeat until everything's been sorted. So TimSort has an average performance of big O n log n. And TimSort works really fast because it gives insertion sort and merge sort a partially sorted or a small array to work with. Also, the inventor of TimSort named it after himself. Tim Peters. That's like the biggest flex of all time. Come on. So Radix Sort works a lot like Counting Sort, except it's a little bit weird. Radix Sort starts looking at the last digit in the array and then sorts it by that number. It then looks at the number before the last analyzed number and then uses that to sort the array again. And if during an iteration a number is not present, it just treats it like a zero. It keeps doing this over and over and over again until the array is fully sorted. And the time complexity for Radix Sort is D times N plus B. D is the amount of numbers in the largest number, N is the number of elements, and B is the base of the numbers being used, so 10 will represent 0 to 9. And just like a lot of the algorithms we've already talked about, Radix Sort can be used in parallel to go even faster. And fun fact, Radix Sort is old, and I mean really old, like around 1887 old. It was also used in the old IBM punch card machines that go all the way back to the 1920s. Let me know in the comments if you want me to go a little bit more in depth on these algorithms. Let me know what concept you want me to easily explain on this channel. If you're interested, I have a video where I give 40 APIs you should use for your next project, as well as a video where I give $10,000 to the worst trading bot I've ever built.